Chuck Bonneville, Julie Hayden, a little after 2 o'clock here on a Tuesday. And I'm pleased to have with us the executive director of Colorado Rising Action, a new player to the scene here in Colorado. Michael, thanks for joining us.
It's good to be on with you guys. Thanks for having me.
Hey, thank you, sir.
Why don't you tell us a little about Colorado Rising Action and who are its sponsors or funders?
So Colorado Rising Action is a relatively new, I think we've been around 6 months or so now, but we're a 501c4 conservative organization that really pushes for conservative policies and principles, but also holds liberal groups and elected officials accountable. So we'll do research, we'll do tracking, go to events where liberal officials are speaking and see if what they're saying is consistent with how they're voting or what they're telling other people. So we really try to get information out to Coloradans, and we have a lot of donors here in Colorado, Colorado-based group, and we're affiliated with a national group that's called America Rising.
Well, and I want to sort of give a plug to you guys, because I've really appreciated the emails and following, your site, because I think what you're doing is something that Republicans have needed here in Colorado for a while. The Democrats have it all over the place, and this is something I think that's been missed and is very useful to help keep people accountable. So, I highly recommend your site.
Is Paul Singer a major sponsor?
He's affiliated with our national group, America Rising.
Okay.
So let me ask you about that. You know, we were talking in the first hour to Patrick Neville, a state Republican, about what he referred to as bathroom gate and the way that the newly elected, not official yet, Senate president, a Democrat, basically fired a staffer for clear retaliation and then had to unfire her. I mean, it's just been, again, I use the word a cluster there. And to me, I think a sign of the kind of overreach. And the other thing that we wanted to talk to you about is, the Democrats, again, I think are manufacturing crises after crises to try to get rid of the Gallagher Amendment.
And Tabor.
And maybe you could explain what that is and what what the risks are.
Sure. I mean, we see this already, that the Democrats are coming out of the gate very aggressive. They just won the election and they're already doing stuff. And even Governor Hickenlooper, as he's leaving, decides to attack Tabor.
He never noticed that Gallagher and Tabor seemed to be contradictory. But weeks before he heads off to become our new president of the United States, or at least
and
in his case, hopefully.
He realizes it.
Oh, wait a minute. I know. They're contradictory. Well, and if we have a Supreme Court packed with all Democrats and one Republican, then we don't have to do it if the legislature won't get blamed. We can just say, oh, that's the court said it.
Well, there's a process to deal with this. And it's something that, there was 13 ballot issues. Statewide ballot issues this year, and fortunately for us, while the elections didn't go that well, the ballot issues did. And there's if there's something wrong, with Tabor and Gallagher that people don't like, they go to the ballot, and you can ask them to fix that. Going to the courts, not knowing what the courts are going to come up with, and Governor Hickenlooper let it go for 8 years, and then as he's going out the door, I think there's a problem with Tabor and Gallagher. I think Tabor is one of the most important policies that our state has, and it's just essential because we can see, if Democrats had their way at the legislature, could do whatever they wanted, we would be in big trouble. And so the people have said, we don't want that tax increase. We don't want that one. We don't want a 2,500-foot setback. But there, there's definitely the Democrats are going to be aggressive in trying to get around Tabor. And that, what Governor Hickenlooper is doing is the first step in that.
Well, and explain the difference between, explain what Gallagher is. I mean, I think people are familiar with Tabor, but less familiar, I think, with the Gallagher Amendment.
Sure. So they're both complicated, especially when they interact. Yeah. But the Gallagher Amendment basically makes it so that local property taxes, there has to be a split between commercial and residential. And that split is 55-45. And so as there's more residential, building, and there has been the assessment rate on the residential has gone down. What happens is because of Tabor, the other side of that equation can't go up. And so what you see is the localities have less money, and then obviously fire and different local services like that are impacted by it. And so basically what it forces people to do is to raise taxes on the local level in order to pay for these services, and a lot of places have done that. And so, the system's been around. Gallagher got passed in 1982, Tabor in 1992, so this is not a new issue. They do interact with each other, but the simple fix is to say, you know what, we're going to adjust Gallagher and we're going to raise property taxes if people want to do that, or some other kind of fix at the ballot box. It's not going to the courts and saying, well, you know, localities right. are getting a little less money. I know the people could give them more, but they're not, so we need to complain about this and get rid of one of them.
Well,
so I think that's where the danger
that
is.
Traditional,
put the ballot, fix on the ballot.
Well, that's right. traditional how Democrats do everything, right? I mean, ask the people to do it. If they don't do it, then just
then
have the courts do it.
Right.
I mean, we approved. We said, okay, marriage is between a man and a woman. They didn't like that. They thought that was very biased and bigoted. So they just had the courts overrule that, saying, well, that's unconstitutional, so you can't have that. And so this would be perfect for the Democrats. We tried to get you idiots to give us all the money, but you refused to do it. And so now we'll have these guys in black robes who are always happy to do it because they're just Democrats with black robes and one Republican. There is one Republican. They'll do it for us, and that'll be great. That'll be great. I mean, this democracy thing is so overrated. So overrated.
Well, I mean, that's the way that we should have it is, you know, having the people have a say on this. And, you know, I think Democrats have typically used the courts. But then, you know, you have a U.S. Supreme Court that's a little bit more conservative now, and they're getting really worried that, you know, that kind of stuff might be used against them. And so I think, you know, the straightforward answer is go to the people. If, you know, these were passed by a majority of Coloradans. If you want to make an adjustment, go back and ask them. But you're going to see the legislature do stuff like this through the courts. You're going to see them try to come up with increased fees, enterprising more things, any way to get around the fact that people
are saying no. What was your opinion of Jerry Sonnenberg, who's the one in the Senate on the Republican side? They made me do it. They made me do it. They tortured me.
A
hospital provider fee, which is just run around Tabor. So they forced me to do it. They were coming after the rural hospitals, and they tortured me, and they waterboarded me, and they made me do it. Why are Republicans always made to do it? They're always going, oh, I don't want to. But those Democrats are very mean, and you just can't fight them.
Yeah, at the time I was working for Americans for Prosperity, and we were fighting against the hospital provider fee, what they called a fix.
Right.
We worked as hard as we could, but there was a lot of pressure. I mean, you had 307 groups pushing for this at the Capitol. At AFP, you know, we were the only one as a registered group there doing it against it. Obviously, Independence Institute and some other groups were against it. But, you know, you look at those reports, it's 307-1. I think there were several legislators that felt the pressure at the Capitol, and, you know, they gave in on this one. But the interesting thing about that is that's another way. So they passed the hospital provider fee. The Tabor cap dropped by $200 million, which was just a deal that they made. Now they're trying to go back and take that money. So this is another way they're trying to get $200 million by just reversing that deal because they won and saying, you know, we don't have to go back to the people. We're just going to take $200 million
and
more.
And Jerry will vote for it. Give him a little bipartisan coverage.
We're talking with Michael Fields from Colorado Rising Action. So let me kind of back up a second and make sure that I have it straight.
Sure.
So you have these two things, the Tabor Amendment and then the Gallagher Amendment. And what happens is the Tabor Amendment says you can't just raise taxes without going to the people. What's happened, though, is with the Gallagher Amendment, it talks about property taxes versus residential versus commercial. And so there are some cities that say, okay, we've been losing money because there's been this growth in housing, and so we need more money, but we can't just raise taxes because Tabor won't let us, so we need the courts to say, yes, we can. Mm-hmm. So my
finish. Tabor lets you raise taxes. You have to get a vote to raise
taxes. That's what I'm saying. So my question is, and this may be really old-fashioned of me, but isn't there yet another option, and that is for the cities to take a look at their budgets and say, well, okay, just like any family has to, and say, okay, here's our income, here's our expenses. If we don't have enough for one category, well, maybe we just spend a little bit less in another category. Maybe we find some waste. Is that just a crazy idea these days
totally
anymore?
Insane. That's totally insane.
I agree with you. I mean, that's the argument we've been making at the state level, too, is to say, look, the budget's going up every year, right? This isn't these budget cuts or we don't have enough money. No, it's going up every single year. On the state level, you're talking $1.5 billion a year. And they're saying, you know what, we can't find $200 or $300 million to bond for roads. I mean, it doesn't make sense. And I think on the local level, too, you're going to see increased revenue. And that's why I trust those voters in that local area to say, you know what? We don't think that we're being efficient enough. I mean, nobody wants, everybody wants firefighters to make sure that if their house is on fire, it goes out. The problem is there must be inefficiencies that they're not voting for
right.
it. And when they are, they're going to say, look, you're doing a good job. We're watching you every day. We're going to your meetings, and we're going to give you a little bit extra property
right.
tax money. That's how the system should
well,
work.
And it would seem to me what they do is they pick things like, I mean, you've got a whole city budget,
mm-hmm.
right? So that they just pick, oh, we don't have enough to pay firefighters. Well, it's like, yes, you do. But that just means you have this budget and you pay mm-hmm. people out of the budget. They just pick something, sort of like the Democrats did when they shut down the government. You're going to
yeah.
shut down the things that hit people the most or that sound the worst. I mean, there are any number of ways a city could adjust its budget without getting rid of the fire department.
Well, no, you got to give the fire guys more. I used to be a fire marshal of a town, and the firemen are great at telling everybody how underpaid they are, and they all have second jobs. You can only work a 3-day week and all that.
Chuck's like the only American who's anti-fireman.
Well, you know, the whole country was until we had 9/11, and then, you know, because they were getting them to EMT services and other things, and then that stopped it all. So the idea that we should just constantly pour money into fire departments is insane.
Well, the idea that's where they have to cut. That's just, it's a fake argument, right?
Well, everything, if you're Denver, Denver's so cool because every tax is approved. I mean, we had three
yeah.
ballot issues, and they, oh, yeah, great, great. What do you want, more money? Oh, yeah, great, 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 yeah. We'll tax ourselves. We'll keep on raising the sales tax, and then we'll claim it's unfair because Denver has sales tax way in excess of everybody else, and that's unfair, so we all ought to give Denver more money. I mean, it's great stuff.
Yeah, and I think, to your point, Julie, it's right. It's what people tend to do when they want increased taxes is put pressure on something that they think is going to, you know, appeal to voters. I mean, you see it with education at the local level. A lot of these school districts, you know, claim they're going to, or they do go to 4-day-a-week classes.
Right,
and
right.
what you find out, though, is you say, you know what, how much money did you save? And there was a district in the metro area that has a $150 million budget. By going to 4 days, they saved $1 million.
Oh.
Right, so less than 1%, but they're able to use that and say, oh my goodness, you know, we need to cut down to 4-day-a-week classes
right.
and get everybody to try to pass a tax increase. It's not even saving that much money. So I think there's definitely, you have to watch for those. And that's why I trust local voters in most places to say, you know what, we know what's going on here. We know
where
you
do
really
you
need.
Live?
We know how efficient you are.
Where do you live?
I live in Denver County.
Oh,
God, you trust the voters? Come on. You got to be kidding me. You got to be. Now, we're in Westminster. It's not only the fire department.
I trust them more than politicians.
Well, that's a good point. But no, in Westminster, you know, the firemen started, you know, their 3-day week, and the policemen wanted, you know. So all the city employees are now on 4-day week, and, of course, Thursday is not a real day. I mean, it's just pretty soon we're going to have city employees, firemen, policemen, down to about a day and a half, and then we all get to pay the pensions and everything else. But
let me back you up, Michael. So what Hickenlooper has done, just figuring this out mm-hmm. after 8 years, so what he's done is even a bigger end run around everybody, and he's going to take this to the courts now?
Supreme Court.
Yeah,
Supreme Court.
So he brought it to the Supreme Court and brought this question up and said, here's the problem, this is what's going on. What do you propose that we do because of this? What things need to be adjusted in Gallagher in order for us to raise taxes without asking people? And, you know, basically in saying what rate can we charge if we can increase it? So it's thrown
wow.
to the courts to just make up a number.
Yeah.
But the other side
That's
of
cool.
that is a lot of places have passed mill levy increases because of this, right? So do we just reverse those? Or, there's already been adjustments made because of this.
Oh, no.
No, we wouldn't, I know. But I'm just saying, you know, that's we have a current process that's been going on for the last 25 years. People have made adjustments, and now they just want to wipe it out and act like we never passed Gallagher and Tabor.
I think we can become New Jersey if we try hard. You know, just a massively overtaxed state. Massive property taxes.
Illinois.
So you can't even sell your
Illinois
house.
And California.
Illinois, California. We're going to have so
I
much
grew
fun.
Up in Chicago, so I've seen,
oh,
this,
yeah,
I've
yeah,
seen
yeah.
this play out. I grew up in Illinois and saw them raise taxes whenever they want. And states like Wisconsin and Indiana were cutting taxes and regulations, and a lot of businesses went there. And now they can't, you know, pay people that win the lottery in Illinois. So, you know, Tabor is a place or is a policy that has ensured that our economy, you know, has stayed one of the top, and I fear that we might drop in the rankings. We might drop economically if Democrats, you know, continue to try to go around Tabor and are successful.
Well, so I think we can predict disaster coming from the Colorado Supreme Court. I mean, is there anything anyone can do now,
no.
or is this sort
it's
of a
courts?
Let me ask him, Chuck. It's a done deal.
I mean, it'll be interesting to see what the court comes up with. I mean, obviously, they tend to be more liberal in what they come up with, but it's such an open question that I don't know. Are they going to say you can raise it a little bit, or you know, it's totally wiped out? I mean, they have a lot of options,
right.
And so to see how the court responds, I really couldn't guess. I don't think it's going to be the answer that we want, but how bad that answer ends up being, I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's right.
I was going to say, who's going to be fighting like our side, right? Because will
Republican.
It be? Well, no. I mean, so Hickenlooper takes it to the Supreme Court. Is it like the newly elected Democrat Attorney General who will be arguing?
No. They all sit among themselves.
Who's going to be arguing our side?
There are no arguments.
I think this is one where they just get put the question. They pose the question to the Supreme Court and they answer it.
Okay.
So it's kind of like an advisory opinion that everybody's going to have to go along with because the Supreme Court just said it. So it's an interesting approach. The governor has this power to do if it is something that affects all of the people and is an influential decision. And so that's what he decided to do. And so we'll see how it turns out. But I think in the meantime, they're taking these other approaches to get around Tabor, these fees and enterprising and everything else. And so at the legislature, we need to be talking about that and telling the people, you know what, you just voted against tax increases and they're trying to take that money anyway.
Right.
And you saw this with the faster bills in 2009 where they just, you know, tripled fees on cars.
Right.
It made people upset. We have to point these things out when they do it. And, you know, that's why we'll be, you know, at the legislature watching all of this.
Well, the final question then. Yeah, as I said, you guys are a great resource. Where can people go to find out about you? If you need help, where can people go to give that?
Yeah. So our website is ColoradoRisingAction.org. We're on Twitter, we're on Facebook, and we try to keep updating stories, putting out press releases, you know, talking to the media about all this kind of stuff just to inform people. It's education, you know, helps inform voters and they can make those decisions. And on ballot issues, they did a good job this year, you know, on the elected side, you know, not so much. But that's, you know, the kind of system that we live in. And I, you know, really, I love the state and hope the best for it. But we're going to be fighting and not just leaving it to chance.
All right.
Keep up the good work.
Keep it up. That's right. Thank you for your time, sir. We appreciate it.
Thanks for having me on.
Take care.
ColoradoRisingAction.org. I recommend checking it out. They do a good job, I think, keeping up on things.